Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Henry Strozier, and I'll be your host. Today, we begin a course entitled The Medieval World, Part 1, Kingdoms, Empire, and War. Your professor is Thomas F. Madden, a professor and chair of the Department of History at St. Louis University. His numerous scholarly publications include The New Concise History of the Crusades, Enrico Dandolo and the Rise of Venice, and The Fourth Crusade, The Conquest of Constantinople, co-authored with Donald E. Queller. He's a recognized expert on pre-modern European history, frequently appearing in such venues as The New York Times, Washington Post, USA Today, National Public Radio, The Discovery Channel, and the History Channel. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin The Medieval World, Part 1, Kingdoms, Empire, and War. Lecture 1. The End of an Empire and the Beginning of the World. And now, Professor Madden.
In this course, we're going to look at the history of the medieval world with a particular emphasis on the political history of Europe during this period, the history of the various kingdoms, and of course, a few of the wars. If we looked at all of the wars, we would do nothing else but that, because you can pretty much bet that at any point during the Middle Ages, somebody is at war with somebody else. But we'll look at some of the larger, more important wars that took place during this thousand years of history. Perhaps the first place that we might want to think about as we begin a course like this is to ask the question, what is the Middle Ages? And why do we call it the Middle Ages in any case? What is it in the middle of? Most people, when they think of the Middle Ages or think of things that are medieval, what might spring to mind are knights and castles and that sort of thing. But other things that spring to mind are like the Dark Ages, the concept of the Dark Ages, a time of superstition, of very poor hygiene, let's say, a lot of other problems that were affecting Europe at this time. To describe someone as medieval is usually not a compliment. It usually means that they're a little backward or perhaps a little dark and sinister. The medieval world, what we know about it today, however, is very contrary to that conception of the Middle Ages. It was not, we can't call it a period of light, but we can say that there's an awful lot of innovation that occurs during the medieval period. And in this course and in the companion course on the economic and social history of the medieval world, we'll look at a lot of those new innovations, those new ideas, new inventions, all sorts of new things that are coming out of the medieval world. And these things are very, very important. They are aspects of our civilization today, of Western civilization today, that we take for granted. And they come directly out of the experience of the Middle Ages. Well, why is it in the middle? Naturally, if you have a term like medieval, it defines it as a period in relation to the periods that are both before it and after it. What came before it is antiquity, Greece and Rome, in particular Greece and Rome. And what came after it is what historians today call the early modern period, but what was used to be called, and what was called when they first named these things, the Renaissance. Renaissance is French for rebirth. And historians in the 15th century, when history books were being first written and then printed, when they looked to the past, they saw themselves as being a rebirth of learning, of literacy, of humanism, which is what they were. They were humanists. And then they looked to the far past of the ancient Romans. They loved the Roman texts. They loved to read the ancient Romans. They loved the clear evidence of a great civilization that existed just from looking at the ruins that were all around them from the Roman Empire. And they wanted to rebuild that. And that's why they called their own period the rebirth. The 1,000 years that stood between them and the ancient Romans, from their perspective, was a waste of time. It was a period in which the greatness of Rome had collapsed, and that man had, or at least Western man, had wallowed in superstition and darkness. And so it didn't even really qualify to have a name. They simply referred to themselves as the Renaissance, or later the Enlightenment period. So you can tell they're the ones that are making up these names, because they're very congratulatory to them. And then there is antiquity. And then what's in the middle is just the Middle Ages. To understand the Middle Ages, we need to first understand, like in all cases when we look at a period, to understand what came before. What was it built on? And in this case, the Middle Ages was very much built on the ashes of the old Roman Empire. The Roman Empire had been the greatest political and military achievement in Western history to that time. The Roman Empire was enormous. It spanned the entire Mediterranean. It really spanned all of the Western civilization, all unified into one political unit. At one point, at its greatest point, it stretched all the way from Scotland to the Persian Gulf. It was an enormous empire. And it was also the first time that this area, the Mediterranean and Europe and the Middle East, that it was all united and enjoyed unprecedented levels of peace and prosperity. However, everything good can't last. By the 3rd century AD, all of this was starting to unravel. The Roman Republic, which was the original state that had been founded in Rome and then spread, had long since gone away. It had given way to an imperial form of government in which one man, an emperor, or one dynasty, the emperor's family, ruled. Now, they went to this system to get stability in an unstable situation, and it provided stability for the empire just so long as that one man or that one family could hold power securely. But that was becoming increasingly rare by the 3rd century. It was much more common to have a lot of various Roman generals gathering together their legions and then making war against each other in a bid for the imperial throne. The result was a lot of civil war by the 3rd century. We have frequent civil wars erupting throughout the empire. All of that meant instability for business, which means it's going to hurt the economy of Rome. Business does not like instability. It means increased taxation, in fact, very large increases in taxation, to pay for all the soldiers. The military spending in Rome during the 3rd century goes up quite a bit. And it's not surprising. It's because each one of these generals who sees, when he looks in the mirror, the next Roman emperor, needs a strong military to make that case. And as soon as he becomes emperor, it's in his interest to pay off the soldiers, give them bribes, to convince them that he's the one who will do the best for them. So the expenditures for the military grow, as does the size of the military in the Roman system. Well, all of this, of course, is very bad for the economy. Inflation rates go up quite a bit during the 3rd century. This is largely because of the debasing of the coinage. In other words, a way to pay your bills on a short-term basis, which ultimately hurts the economy in the long term. Added to all of this runaway inflation and now increasing unemployment that Rome has to deal with, there's also the problems of new pressures from the outside, particularly on the Western European borders, which is being caused by much larger population migrations that are occurring in Germany and then further east in Asia. So the pressure on the frontiers of Rome is becoming more acute. And therefore, the Roman world is really beset in the third, particularly by the late third century, both within and without. It is sometimes said that the first really medieval emperor of the Roman Empire is Diocletian. And there's some truth to that. He's certainly an emperor who is beginning to point toward a new world, a new period that we'll be going into at this point. The Emperor Diocletian came to the throne in 284 AD, and he did it by what had become the fairly normal method. He rose up through the military. He was of very humble origins. What made him different, though, was that once he got power, he immediately began instituting comprehensive reforms to try to fix the system, which was clearly broken. And there were a lot of various reforms that he put into place. We don't need to discuss all of them right now, but at least we want to talk at least about some of the most important ones. How to deal with the problems with the economy, how to deal with the fact that the money is virtually worthless. One way to deal with all of this instability that exists is to change the administration of the empire. Now, Rome at this point had about 60 provinces, and they were all organized in different ways during the different centuries. Most of them had separate deals based on how they had actually come into the empire. Some of them were senatorial, under senatorial control. Some were imperial. What Diocletian does is he gets rid of all of those distinctions, and instead he divides the whole enchilada, the whole empire, into new provinces, which are there are 116 of them. Each one is given a local leader, and then he groups these into 12 different larger regional organizations, which end up being called dioceses, named after him. And each one of these dioceses then gets a vicar who is the governor of that particular diocese. Then those 12 are divided into what are called prefectures, which are each one has three dioceses in it. And each one of those prefectures then has a praetorian prefect who is over that. And those four praetorian prefects are directly answerable to the emperor. So you can see that what he's doing is he's creating a more rational system, and he's setting up a political accountability, a political administration, where all the ties eventually come to the emperor. He also makes the emperor actually exist now legally. Prior to this, although emperors have been around for a long time, they didn't really exist legally. Legally, Rome was still a republic. Now, that's all changed. Now the emperor really does exist. And he's no longer called a princeps, which is what they used to call them. They were kind of a first among equals, or at least that's the way they were viewed. Instead, he now becomes a dominus, a lord. Everything about the emperor becomes now sacred. The court is sacred. His person is sacred. He dresses now in the Eastern style of lots of jewels all over the place and beautiful raiment. He's not wearing a toga just walking around with the guys. It's very hard to see the emperor any longer. And even if you gain an audience, you speak to the emperor on your belly and you speak off to the side, not directly to him. It's a different approach to the emperor. There are going to be, under Diocletian's reforms, there are now going to be two of those emperors, because what he says is that the empire has become so large that what happens is that the emperor will go and deal with a problem, say, in Gaul. And as soon as he and most of his troops are all the way in Gaul, what's today France, then immediately Roman generals in Egypt will revolt and they'll start carving out sections for themselves. And that mean, and they know they can do that because the emperor is so far away. So what he does is, for administrative purposes, he divides up the empire into two. And he puts two emperors, one in the east and one in the west. He then sets up a system of choosing a successor called a Caesar. And in that way, he hopes that this will take away some of the insecurity and uncertainty about who the next emperor will be, so that you'll have somebody there ready right away to be emperor as soon as the current emperor either resigns or dies. So the reason this is important for the Middle Ages is that the empire, for administrative purposes, and bear this in mind, is being divided into two. We now have an Eastern Roman Empire and a Western Roman Empire. Now, they're still the same entity. The emperors on both sides still work together. But they are going to be separately controlled administratively. The emperor in the East, there is no capital initially in the East. But the emperor in the East is jurisdiction there. The emperor in the West has general jurisdiction in the West. His theoretical capital in the West, of course, is Rome, although in reality, most of the emperors by this time are spending their time in Milan. Diocletian also institutes a number of economic reforms. We won't talk too much about those because in the end, very few of them are, in fact, none of them really are very successful. He does try to fix the coinage a bit, but is unable to do so. He institutes wage and price controls. In fact, he sets up legal prices that must be paid for all goods and services. These, as always occurs with these types of things, they're generally ignored, and they create a black market system. He tries to set up what amounts to a caste system in which people had to stay in their jobs that they currently had, particularly farmers and civic authorities, and also that their children had to take over those positions after they died. As I said, most of these reforms will end up going by the wayside because they will not be very successful. Diocletian also institutes some religious reforms. He came to believe that the devotion to the state, of the Roman state, would be best served by restoring the practices of the old state religions. And so he, by various decrees, by 303, he was requiring everyone to, in some way, take part in the Roman state religion, the pagan religions. Now, this fell hardest on Christians, and particularly later when Diocletian never liked the Christians. Christians at this time constituted about 10% of the population or so, and they tended to be the lower classes. There were some aristocratic women who were Christians, but most of the people that you would have met that were Christians tended to be the slaves or the lower urban classes. Diocletian didn't think much of them. In fact, he and others considered it to be a symptom of decline. When there was a kind of a soothsaying event going on, this was an attempt to try to divine the future. Some pagan priests complained to Diocletian that they couldn't get a good read on the future because there were some Christians nearby who kept making the sign of the cross. For Diocletian, this was the last straw. And so he instituted an empire-wide persecution of Christians. This is really the largest persecution of Christians that had happened up until this time, which begins in different parts of the empire at different times. But right around 303, we have a very large persecution, state persecution going on. Diocletian, now that he's set up this system, abdicates in 305. And he kind of goes off into retirement, the idea being that he's going to watch the system and see if it works. It already starts clunking away. It starts breaking down almost immediately. And so he has to keep stepping in and keep fixing it. But eventually he dies in 316, so he's not really around to fix it anymore. The next really important emperor for our purposes will be the Emperor Constantine. And it's really Constantine, we can definitely see that we are now moving into the Middle Ages. Now, Roman Empire is still around, of course, but the way it's changing, we can see the foundation that's being laid here for the Middle Ages. Constantine came to the throne. We don't need to go into great detail, but he comes to the throne by the usual method, that is by getting his troops to proclaim him emperor and then marching on Rome. What is critically different, though, with Constantine is that on the march to Rome, on the march down into Italy from Gaul, which is where he was, he has a vision in the sky. This vision is of a cross, and with the cross, the words, in hoc signo vinces, in this sign you will conquer. Constantine knew about Christianity, and so he must have assumed that this was a vision from the Christian God. He himself was not Christian, but we are told by his biographer and a later church historian that later that evening, he also had a dream in which Jesus Christ came to him and showed him a battle standard and told him that he should take this battle standard with him and he would be victorious. And the battle standard was the what's sometimes called the labrarum or the chiro, the two Greek letters, chi and rho, superimposed over each other. Looks like a P and an X on top of each other. This symbol was a traditional Christian symbol. It had been around for many centuries. Constantine now adopts it. Now, his understanding of Christianity is pretty light understanding. But what he's most concerned about right now, he's a general, and what he cares about is winning. And he's in a bad situation. The current emperor, Maxentius, has a much larger force than he does. And therefore, it's very unlikely that he's going to be successful. Maxentius also has Rome. And so, therefore, it's not surprising that he's got the upper hand here. Constantine marches, however, on Rome. He's got now this new battle standard. It's all over the place. And at the Battle of Milvian Bridge in 312, he defeats Maxentius. This is one of those battles that are just crucial to history. There are only a few of these where if the battle had gone a different way, all of the rest of history would have been very, very, very different. As a result of his victory at the Battle of Milvian Bridge, he now becomes the emperor in the West. And Constantine believes very strongly, it's clear from his letters and from the things that other people are writing about him, that he really believes that God, Christ, had come to him and specifically chosen him to be the emperor, not only to rule over the Roman people, but also to fix his church. The church, the Christian church, it was being persecuted, but it also had a lot of other problems with it as well. Constantine, therefore, in 313, along with his colleague in the East, issues the Edict of Milan, which makes it legal to worship any religion. It outlaws the persecution. So without persecution, now the Christians are free to worship. And in fact, more than being just free, because the emperor himself has become Christian, Christianity now becomes almost overnight, not just a religion of the lower classes, but a religion of the highest elites. And it's really after the conversion of Constantine and the conversion of the imperial family to Christianity that we start seeing now a dramatic increase in the number of conversions to Christianity, an enormous increase. Over the next 60 years, virtually the entire Roman world will convert to Christianity. You'll still have pockets of pagans, mostly among intellectuals in the cities, and of course Jews, but the vast majority, a good 85 to 90% of the population within 60 years will be Christian. It's a dramatic, dramatic change in a relatively short period of time. Constantine is also very interested in building churches. You start getting now churches being built in Rome, big churches, really nice churches like the original St. John Lateran on Lateran Hill, the original St. Peter's Shrine, and then later Basilica are built now at this time. You start getting a lot of churches that are dotting the landscape, and not just in Rome, but in other cities as well. Constantine, in dealing with the problems of the church, he has to deal with a couple of heresies that are afflicting the church at this time. Heresy is extremely important now that the emperor is himself Christian, because heresy causes division within the faith. And division within the faith can lead to, particularly as Rome becomes all Christian, can lead to division within the state. It's also true that Christianity, unlike earlier religions, argues that the institution of the church is necessary for the salvation of the faithful, because it's the institution of the church, which Christians believe was formed and created by Christ, that the apostles were given special authority to perform the sacraments, and to lay on hands to allow others to perform the sacraments, in particular the Eucharist, the Mass, but also baptism and later confession. So these sacraments are necessary for the faithful, and you can't do them yourself. You can't just do it at home as a home-based religion. A priest has to perform the sacrament. The priest has to have received his authority to do so from a bishop. And that bishop has to have received his what's called apostolic authority by somebody who received it ultimately from an apostle. So there's this direct line. Also, to understand when questions come up about the faith, the apostles themselves would meet, pray for guidance from the Holy Spirit, and then because of the binding and loosing authority that Christ had given to them, they would then decide what the truth was. That, of course, was difficult to do in the last few centuries because Christianity was scattered all over the Roman Empire and because it had been persecuted recently. That means that different Christians in different parts of the empire come up with different answers to questions. One of the heresies that was causing the most trouble in the fourth century is the heresy of Arianism. And Arianism is going to keep popping up in this course. Arianism was begun by a bishop, Arius, in Alexandria. And it was an attempt to try to square the idea of Jesus Christ as God with Greek philosophy, with the learning of scholars. The idea, if you accept that God is perfect, and if you accept that man is imperfect, then there's a disconnect here when we try to explain how God then can become man, as Christians believe that Christ did. How is it possible for God to become imperfect? And if he does become imperfect, then doesn't that mean he's not God? This was a fierce dispute. It's a Christological dispute that's going on, particularly in Egypt at this time, where you have a very large Christian population. And Arius argues, and his followers argue, that Christ is divine, but he is not a deity the same way that God is. He's not the Godhead. He is part of creation. So, in other words, he's better than anyone you know. He's different than all the other humans, but he's almost a sort of a demigod in the old pagan system, a kind of a halfway between God and man. Now, the Orthodox, or what will become the Orthodox view, is that Christ is both God and man, that he has a fully human nature and a fully divine nature. This is argued, and it's causing a lot of problems. People are burning down each other's churches over this. And Constantine, therefore, wants to deal with it. What he does is he calls a council together at Nicaea in Asia Minor, what's today Turkey. It's a town that's today called Iznik. And in 325, they meet there, very nice place, right on the bank of a beautiful lake. He has a big imperial palace there. And everyone comes and they meet. The bishops from all over the empire come. They debate this question. They pray for guidance. And they finally decide that Arianism is wrong. And it is now a heresy. At the Council of Nicaea, and really throughout Constantine's dealings with the church, what we can see here is the beginnings of a medieval approach to church and state, one that will continue to exist in the periods afterwards. Prior to this, church and state were usually connected. Sometimes they're the same thing. In almost all human societies, church and state are essentially connected. The religion and the state are one. Now, you have priests. The priests are part of government. It's government's job to keep gods happy. And most governments also prop up their authority by arguing that they are themselves chosen by God, that they are the go-between between God and man or whatever. Here, however, we have something very different. The Christian church, the Catholic church, already exists here in the Roman Empire. It existed for several centuries, three centuries, before the emperor actually converted. Now, the emperor comes into this, and he is not a priest, and he's not a bishop, and he therefore does not have apostolic succession. He does believe that he is chosen by God. There's no doubt about that. But he does not place himself in the position of actually defining doctrine. He doesn't decide himself whether Arius is right or Athanasius is right. Instead, what he does is he bankrolls the meeting at Nicaea. He brings all of them together. And then once they've decided, he enforces it. Therefore, and that's what makes things different now. Constantine sees heresy as a crime against the state. And that means once the Arians are defined as being heretical, they must either come back to orthodoxy or they're exiled. The state will exile them for that. But the Constantine, as the secular ruler, is separate from the bishops, in particular the Bishop of Rome, who has a kind of a preeminent authority. This is the Pope. It's a separate thing. The church and the state are separate. They work together. They have close ties together, but they are separate entities. And that's what's uniquely Western about this. And it comes out of Constantine and his conversion to Christianity. And it's the reason that we today still view the idea that the church and the state as being separate, as being a matter of course. The other major initiative of Constantine's that will have a lot of impact for the future will be his foundation of the city of Constantinople. This is a city which is right at the tip of Thrace. It was right on the Bosphorus. It was really put at the crossroads of the world. It commanded the land route from Europe to Asia, and it commands the sea route from the Black Sea to the Mediterranean. Constantine chooses this site, the site of an old Greek city called Byzantion, and he refounds a new city, which he calls New Rome. But what is quickly called by everybody else, Constantine's city, which Constantinopolis in Greek, or Constantinople. This city, an enormous city, heavily fortified, will become the capital now of Rome in the East. And when Rome collapses in the West, that will still remain. Constantinople will remain that core of what's left of the Roman Empire. And we'll talk a lot about Constantinople throughout the rest of this course. After Constantine's death, his sons take over, and the empire after that begins moving into its last act, at least in the West. The outside pressures on the empire continue to become greater and greater. You have a number of these German tribal groups that are pushing stronger and stronger against the frontiers of Rome. Now, these German tribal groups are, for the most part, Romanized, at least in some way. And most of them are Christian, at least the ones that are pushing up against the frontiers. The problem is that these German groups, the big tribes are the Goths and the Vandals. There are others that we'll talk about later. But the Goths, particularly, are Arian Christians. They were missionized by Arian missionaries. And so although Arianism is declining by the end of the 4th century in the Roman Empire, it's coming in anew with these Goths, because they're all Arian Christians. In 376, the Eastern Emperor, Valens, allows thousands of Goths to cross the Danube and to settle in Thrace. And he does this, one is he wants to use them as kind of allies. They call them federati. But he also wants to get them out of the way of other groups that are coming, primarily the Huns. There are problems, however, in the resettlement camps. And as a result of this, the Goths revolt, and they start causing havoc throughout Thrace, taking cities. Valens brings up his legions in 378 at the Battle of Adrianople, and it's the first really major Roman defeat in about 5 centuries. An enormous defeat. The emperor himself is killed. Thousands and thousands of Roman soldiers are killed. And it leaves the Goths complete freedom to ransack Greece as much as they want. This is obviously the final curtain call for the empire in the West. More tribes like the Vandals and the Franks begin moving in now into Western Europe. And they start dismembering the Roman Empire little by little. By 476, we have a situation in which Gothic chieftains are really running things in Italy and in other parts of the empire. And one of them finally deposes the last Roman emperor in the West in 476, a man named a young child named Romulus Augustulus. He is deposed, and the German chief, Odovacar, gives the purple to the emperor in Constantinople, saying that he will rule Italy instead as his servant. It's a fiction, of course, but it's an important fiction for the Germans, who really do not want to accept the fact. In fact, no one wants to accept the fact that the Roman Empire has died in the West. They continue to keep up the pretense that it still exists, and that it's just being ruled by Constantinople, and that Germans are the ones who are doing it for the emperor. Well, in our next lecture, we will look at the effects on Western Europe in these first years after the fall of the empire in the West, and then look at the response of the Eastern Empire to the German attacks during the reign of Justinian.
This ends Lecture 1. The Medieval World, Part 1. Lecture 2. The Empire Strikes Back. Justinian I and the Reconquest of the West.
In our last lecture, we looked at the fall of the Roman Empire in the West. And in this lecture, we want to look at the immediate after effects of that event, of the fall of the Roman Empire. Now, I want to reiterate that although historians will traditionally say that 476 means the fall of the Roman Empire in the West, and if you're ever on Jeopardy and they ask you when the Roman Empire fell, it's a good idea to say 476. However, could you jump into a time machine and go to 476 and ask people around what happened this year, none of them would have said the Roman Empire fell. And if you had insisted that no, everyone says so, everyone says the Roman Empire fell in 476, they would have thought you were crazy. From their perspective, nothing really had changed. Yes, German tribes had come into the Western Empire, sure. But these weren't invaders. These were federati. These were allies. And yes, they had conquered cities and sacked them and killed people and all of that. But they all had Roman titles to them. Even the Germans themselves would have insisted, German leaders would have insisted that no, not at all, that they were patricians. They had titles. They had authority given to them by the emperor in Constantinople. And certainly the Roman population in Western Europe would have insisted that, no, the empire was still alive and well. There were problems, of course. There were lots of problems. But the empire itself still existed. Now, we know from hindsight that it doesn't exist, that really what we have here is a situation in which different Germanic tribes have invaded Western Europe and have set up for themselves independent kingdoms. And in each of these independent kingdoms, the Germans are the ones who are in charge. They've got all the weapons. They are the kings of the areas. And they have beneath them a Roman population. But in reality, that's what the situation is. Now, bear in mind as we talk about what's going on here, that those German overlords who have conquered these regions, they are Arian Christians. The Roman population that exists in those areas that are conquered are Catholics, Christians. So they're all Christians, but there is a dichotomy here. There's a tension here between those two forms of Christianity. And that will cause problems later on. What about the eastern portion of the Roman Empire? Well, that has its own set of problems. The not so much with the Germans, although as we saw in the last lecture, the Goths did break into Greece and Thrace and caused a lot of problems there. But I should say something also about nomenclature. Henceforth, when we talk about the Roman Empire in the East, we'll use the term that historians use for that, which is the Byzantine Empire. Historians use this term to differentiate the Roman Empire in the East after the fall of Rome in the West from the Roman Empire in the East before the fall of Rome in the West. It is not actually a name that was used at the time. No one called the Byzantine Empire the Byzantine Empire. They called it the Roman Empire, and they would all throughout its life. The citizens of the Byzantine Empire were not called Byzantines. They were called Romans. So it's a completely made-up name, like a lot of things in medieval history, made up by Enlightenment historians. But it's one of those things where we're just stuck with the name. And so we will here refer to it as the Byzantine Empire and the people who live in it as the Byzantines. The Byzantine Empire was not immune from the problems of the German barbarians either. As I mentioned, the Goths are still causing problems in Thrace and Greece. And a lot of these Goths were able to get into positions of very powerful, even preeminent positions in the imperial government in Constantinople, much the same way that they were able to do in Italy. And they do this because they work their way up through the military. They become big leaders in the military, these Germans, and they get the power, and the emperors become weaker and weaker. In the West, the emperors have become puppets before they were finally deposed. In the East, it's not quite that bad. In fact, the Eastern Empire, the Byzantine Empire, is able to deal with these problems very effectively by the Emperor Zeno, who is emperor from 474 to 491. What he did was he appointed the Gothic leader, the Gothic chieftain, Theodoric, who was in Greece, as a patrician. He gave him the title patrician. And then he gave him authority and ordered him to take his Gothic armies, which is, and for these Germans, it's not just the armies, it's everybody. It's the wives, the kids, the wagons, it's everything. These are not only invasions, they're migrations. And to take all of them and head off to Italy. to overthrow what Zeno calls the usurper Odovacar. Remember, he was the one who deposed Romulus Augustulus in 476. Theodoric takes him up on this, and so he marches to Italy, fights Odovacar. Now, this is the Goths fighting the Goths here. And they fight each other almost to a standstill, although Theodoric has the upper hand. Finally, in 493, they decide to make peace. And to seal the peace, they have a big peace banquet in which both Theodoric and Odovacar come. And at the peace banquet, Theodoric, with his own hands, murders Odovacar. So that takes care of the problem with Odovacar. Theodoric, therefore, now emerges as the ruler of the Goths in Italy. And this now is, he takes the title both patrician, but he also takes the title king, Rex. But he's very careful. He never actually says what he's king of. He just says he's king. He doesn't say he's king of Italy. He doesn't say he's king of Rome. He just says he's king. That way the Romans could say, well, what he really means is that he's king of the Goths. But because Romans are allergic to the term king, they don't like the idea of kings. Well, now Zeno, you can probably guess, Zeno's plan here was obviously to get Theodoric out of Greece and to have him just go and fight another Goth. And it worked pretty well. As a result of this, now Greece and Thrace are pretty much clear of Goths. And because of this, subsequent emperors are going to be very successful in getting the last Goths that are in positions of authority in Constantinople out. So the Byzantine Empire in the east is going to be able to deal with this problem of the Goths in a very effective way. So the Eastern Empire, the Byzantine Empire, will continue after this without a problem from German invasions. The West, of course, is a whole other ballgame. Theodoric tries to put together a commonwealth. He has this kind of an idea of creating a kind of a commonwealth in which the Arian Goths work together with the Roman population. And this commonwealth idea at first seems to be going fairly well, but there remains this tension still between the Roman population in Italy, which is Catholic, and the German Arian population. This was not too much of a problem for Theodoric during much of his reign, because in Constantinople, the subsequent emperors went over to another heresy called the Monophysite heresy, which again is a Christological heresy. It has to do with the nature of Christ, whether he has one nature or two natures, God and man, or whether he has just one nature. The Monophysite obviously believes that he has one nature. Well, this heresy of the Monophysite heresy is very popular in the East, and the Patriarch and the emperors have become Monophysite. Well, that means the Catholics in Europe really can't look to the emperor for support in Constantinople, and therefore they're content to be friends with Theodoric as long as he's content to allow them to worship in peace. However, as we'll talk about later, the Franks, another German group up north, will, around this time, convert to Catholicism. And when the Franks, as Catholics, start attacking the Goths in the north, who are Arians, well, all you got to do is look at the faces of the Romans in Italy, and they clearly have a smile on their face. They like the fact that these now Catholic Germans are defeating the Arian Germans. And this starts causing tensions uh, for uh, between Theodoric. In fact, Theodoric begins to suspect that the Romans themselves, even the Pope, are acting in a treasonous fashion against him, that they're seeking to find some way to overthrow him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.